Okay, we're going to get started. Welcome to the second Semenas Colloquium session of fall 2022. It's my pleasure to introduce the theme today from our larger theme on higher education and reformation across the Middle East and North Africa, a geopolitical exploration. I'll have 3 to 4 minutes of an overview for our new guests today, our experts joining us about what this colloquium is. Some of you have heard this feel a little bit already, but we also have new public audiences joining us every week. So the SEMENAS is short for the Center for Middle East and North African Studies at the University of Michigan, where the study of Middle East and North Africa as a region has been happening since 1889. We became a formal program of study in 1961, so we celebrated our 60th anniversary here last year. Today, we are also a center, more specifically a National Resource Center of the U.S. Department of Education, which means we not only conduct teaching across the tertiary sector from undergraduate to postdoctoral instruction and training, we also do original research, but very importantly, we also have an important mission to the public, and this colloquium is an important annual tradition in that way. Each year, the colloquium selects a topic, a lens by which to understand the region for its diversity in language, cultural, history, politics, and even economic and other disciplinary angles. This year's angle is topic and theme is higher education and reformation across the Middle East. Each of these 7 weeks, we have usually two guest experts from around the world. And today's session focuses loosely on higher education in the region from a focus on the global economy and the fourth industrial revolution and how it affects and positions higher education in the Middle East and North Africa. Our co-sponsors for today's meeting are the University of Michigan International Institute, the University of Michigan School of Education, and the University of Michigan Center for the Study of Higher Education and Post-Secondary Education. Our two experts today are first Dr. Shayna Cohen, who is the director of TASC, T-A-S-C, an independent think tank based in Dublin, which focuses on issues related to inequality and democracy in Ireland and the European Union. She is also an affiliated lecturer in the Department of Sociology at the University of Cambridge and is a co-editor of the Journal of North African Studies. Dr. Cohen's talk today is entitled, Why Doesn't Higher Education Lead to Jobs in North Africa? Our second speaker will be Dr. Magdalena Karolak, who is an associate professor of humanities and social sciences at Zayed University in the United Arab Emirates. She's a professor who has published more than 50 journal articles and book chapters considering topics as diverse as gender relations, social media, culture and identity, the political system transformations affecting MENA countries. She's also an author of 3 scholarly monographs. And her talk today is entitled The Complexity of Tertiary Education Reforms in the Gulf Cooperation Council, with a case study of Bahrain. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Dr. Shayna Cohen to get us started in our talks. Thank you.
Thank you for having me, and forgive me if there are technological issues. And thank you, Ms. Emil, for inviting me. I really appreciate this. I haven't looked at that article in a while, but in preparing for this talk, I realized how interested I am in the issue. As per the introduction, I've had a bit of a career, not a linear career trajectory, and I'm no longer full-time in academia. So part of my interests reflect what I'm doing now, which is policy. And it's Ireland and the EU, but we address global issues, which is the relation in it that reflects upon the research that was done for the article that on Morocco, higher education in Morocco, but also just my general interests in Morocco and North Africa. More generally, and that is the relationship between sort of economic policy and democracy and inequality. And so in talk, my short talk today, those themes will keep coming up. So I've had, as I just mentioned, I've had two really longstanding interests since I started to do research in North Africa, and that was a very, very long time ago. I first went to Cairo on a fellowship from Princeton. And I spent a couple of years there, and then I have spent, I lose track of how many years I've spent in Morocco. So maybe 6 to 7 years in total in the region. And my interest is, I've had two longstanding interests. And the first is in employment and how economic policy affects not just job creation and jobs, but also sense of self and role, political and social identity. And that has obviously had serious implications for the region for if you just look at the Arab Spring. And the second is on the role of civil society, the increasing politicization of civil society, because there aren't many other outlets for political expression. Now, the question is, how does higher education fit into all of this? And that's what I want to talk to you about briefly today. In short, despite investment in public and private higher education in a country like Morocco, or even as we're going to hear in the Gulf, there's been substantial investment in higher education. It hasn't necessarily produced better jobs or even more jobs or better opportunities for young people. It hasn't sort of made social mobility easier or clarified trajectories of social mobility, particularly as I'm going to discuss in relationship to what existed after independence in the 50s for Morocco or other countries in the region like Tunisia or Algeria. It hasn't meant that having a higher education necessarily gives you a higher social status as it did previously. And very critically for the region, it hasn't necessarily meant greater intellectual freedom and capacity to produce high level, internationally competitive, if you want to use that word, if you can submit peer-reviewed journals, higher level research. So you can't really understand higher education in the region without situating it within the context of job creation, the public sphere, and the political and economic policy context. And that in Morocco is just a case study, but it's an interesting case study because it is, one, a very good student of the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund, and two, it advertises itself as being, and it has for decades advertised itself as being, a bridge between Europe and North Africa and increasingly sub-Saharan Africa. But you can't really understand investment in third level education in Morocco without, again, job creation, but in critically other themes that I'd like to focus on are the social status and economic position of faculty, especially in the public sector. So you could see it even in countries like the US, or I could tell you about like in Europe or the UK, where the diminishment of the status of faculty under economic policy since the 90s has had an impact on higher education. Another theme I want to touch upon is the privatization of higher education. There's a question, and it's still unanswered, if this privatization is exacerbating inequality and limiting social mobility. Then there aren't questions being asked within policy about the connection between higher education, skills, and your sense of contribution to society. And the last, as I've just mentioned, the importance of independent research for stimulating public debate on national and local challenges, as well as attracting investment and stimulating the national and local economy, which would mean creating jobs for young people. So there are a number of themes. On one level, is investment in higher education actually producing good jobs that people are happy with? And then the other level is, how are these institutions themselves functioning? Now, the background for this is the economic policy context and the shift since the 80s for market reform and structural adjustment, which is how Morocco became to be a good student of the international financial institutions. After 1979, when King Hassan II, who is the father of the current king, Mohammed the VI, he invested heavily in, like all other countries post-independence in a colonial era, invested heavily in public services, including public education. This is public education throughout, to have a more educated workforce, particularly to replace the loss of French intellectuals, French faculty, and French civil servants after independence. So that investment in creating a middle class that was loyal to the regime was costly. And so by the end of the 70s, early 90s, Morocco, like many other countries in the what was called the Third World, had to go to international financial institutions like the World Bank or the Paris Club in Europe and ask for loans and say that I can't pay my debt. So what happened, they ended up on what's called a structural adjustment in market reform trajectory. So the structural adjustment program meant slashing public services and meant reducing the public debt, which meant not hiring necessarily people who'd graduated from universities. And that with that, correspondingly, unemployment rates shot up amongst third level education graduates, much higher than those who hadn't finished secondary school or who finished secondary school. And those rates have remained high since then. And I'll show you some slides in just a second. The people I've interviewed over the past several decades who are typically under 40, they want secure job like their parents had or their grandparents had, and they're willing to accept low pay, but that means the public sector, and those jobs just aren't available in the same quantity as before. So if I were to show you, and this is gonna, let me see if I can do this. There we go. Okay, so if I were to show you some statistics, can everybody see my PowerPoint? Is that a?
Yes.
Okay, cool. All right, so if I were to show you some statistics about higher education and unemployment in Morocco, you can see this is, that unemployment, sorry, it's a perverse graph, but that unemployment rates have been higher, substantially higher than rural areas. Urban educated, urban unemployment rates have been substantially higher than rural. And then this may be difficult to read, but if I were to show you right here, you have a diploma, to have a diploma, which is higher than the baccalaureate. This is an extraordinary rate. If you look at 1999 to 2021, it's always above 20, except for a few years around the Arab Spring. And that it's sometimes approaching 30%, okay? And it's, if you look at without a degree, look how low those rates are. Rural areas going into agriculture or sort of manual labor. But if you have a higher level degree, you're not guaranteed employment. In fact, a quarter of you may not find a job. Okay, again, if you look at the, again, it's going backwards for some people, but if you look at those without a degree, that's a pretty low level unemployment rate. Not having a degree, it's quite high. Okay, so if you look at men and women, if you look at women without a degree, fairly low, very high, very, very, very high for, it's a quarter of women, and it was worse about 20 years ago, who have a degree, don't have, or they have in this sense, and you know what, for some reason the green didn't show, the having a degree, but it's higher for women, it's about a quarter. Again, it's about a quarter for men. So it's slightly higher for women than it is for men. It doesn't mean that there's not a substantial, sorry, this might be difficult to read, but it doesn't mean that there's not a substantial problem with not in NEET, which means not in employment, education, or training. Morocco has a higher than average ranking for the MENA region in terms of young people who are out of education, employment, and training. But again, this is the context in which you want to situate higher education. If you're going to talk about investment in higher education, has it led to job creation? No, not necessarily. In fact, it's been a persistent problem for at least 40 years. So 30 years. If you're going to look at its relationship, you have sorry, let me just backtrack. As everybody knows who's studied the region, the Arab Spring started because of unemployment among this population, not having any opportunities. But it's not just employment. And this has been the other interest I've had since conducting my dissertation research, is how the unemployed in particular, or people who are in poorly paid jobs and don't see a clear trajectory of social mobility, how they've translated their social identity and political identity in an atmosphere where they're governed by semi-authoritarian or a non-democratic political context. What they've increasingly done, what I've found, is they go to work in civil society, particularly at a local level, they go to work for local NGOs. In Morocco, this kind of translation into social activism has been facilitated by a national program funded in part by the World Bank called the National Initiative for Human Development. And that has been a way of tempering, in some ways, frustration with lack of employment and lack of clear opportunities for social mobility, because it has allowed people to become active and have an impact. But it also reveals the existential value of having an education. It's not just about jobs, which is a mistake that aid agencies and governments often make. It's also about a sense of self within a society. Just to back that statement up, there was a World Bank report on youth unemployment in Tunisia, and it quoted a man from Sidi Bouazid, which is where the Arab Spring started. And it said, quote, "For us, unemployment is a kind of blasphemy. An unemployed is not a person. Society itself does not accept him. He is not part of the circle of society. That is the true meaning of unemployed, a person who is not active in the heart of society. Tell me, what use is that person?" Unfortunately, government policies in Tunisia and Morocco, as well as other countries in the region, haven't either alleviated the unemployment or the alienation anxiety, despite, I would say, the impact of programs like INDEASH, the national initiative in Morocco, because it's facilitated doing something else with your time and cultivating at least an identity at a local level. But at the same time, there's been substantial investment in higher education, with the objective of upskilling the population and diversifying the economy. But we're going to talk a little bit about why this investment has not significantly reduced unemployment amongst the young educated population, or created enough high quality jobs to demonstrate for young people that they can have a promising future in their country, in their home country, because a lot of the people who are migrating, especially from Tunisia, are often educated, even illegal avenues of migration. So I'll just show you briefly two things. I'm going to show you what the implication has been, as we've just seen the rates of unemployment, and I'll show you how they've corresponded with the declining sense of satisfaction in democracy. So hopefully you can see this slide. So if you look at in Tunisia and Morocco, satisfaction with the education system. In Tunisia, it's 3%, and in Morocco, it's 9%. This is from the Arab Barometer in 2021. The satisfied population that's satisfied is 37% in Morocco and 20% in Tunisia. And if you look at dissatisfied, which is important, it's almost the same as satisfied. If you look at completely dissatisfied, then you have a higher figure than satisfied. And in Tunisia, it's even worse. If you look at this statistic, 43% of those interviewed in the Arab Barometer were completely dissatisfied. This corresponds, again, sorry, this is a bit, I don't know if you can, sometimes I lose screen sharing when I shift to slideshow. But if you look at this, if you can see it, it corresponds with dissatisfaction in the government's overall performance. So you're unhappy with your employment situation, you're unhappy with education, and you're unhappy with the government overall. So you could say that satisfied is 56% in Morocco, but you look at the dissatisfied, 17%, completely dissatisfied. And but if you look at Tunisia, which you saw those striking statistics about dissatisfaction with the education system, you can see also dissatisfaction with the government's performance overall. Okay. And for those of you who follow politics in Tunisia, you know that it's had a significant backsliding from democracy. If you break apart these statistics in the Arab Barometer, you'll see that those who are more educated, let's say MA and above, or mid-level diploma, secondary, they tend to be more dissatisfied. they're not satisfied with the direction of the country. The problem then is that you end up migrating, or you it creates, as we've seen, not just political instability, but an ongoing social problem that crosses generations. So the interviews and secondary source analysis that I've conducted in research for this article, or ongoing research on NGOs and civil society, what they've done is reflect the changes. If we're to speak about intergenerational transformation, after independence, you had a significant amount of state investment, as I mentioned earlier, in higher education. But it wasn't just the investment, it was the atmosphere and the symbolism that the university had, in that this is a method of achieving a certain social status. In addition, the university itself had enough status, and the faculty had enough status to engage in intellectual debate. They were free to engage, even in a repressive regime under Hasan Dud, they were free to engage in political debate, or they engaged in political debate regardless. And this corresponded with the period before the 80s, where there was a nationalist economic policy and an incentive to create a middle class. In the article, I talk about how there was a French-Moroccan sociologist, Paul Pascon, who was also mysteriously died in the Western Sahara and was a critic of the regime. But he had a significant role in training what would be the senior faculty, very highly respected public intellectuals in Morocco today, like Mohamed Tozzi, Abdelkader Khatibi, who passed away a few years ago, Abdallah Hamoudi, who is was a professor at Princeton, and then the historian Mohamed Ennaji, and then there's a politician, Tammy Khiari. Now, they all tacked to the left, but they engaged in not just public debate, and they still continue to do that, but they created a journal called the Malif, which became very well known. It was founded by Zakia Daoud in the 60s, and it lasted for more than 20 years until it was banned in 1988. But it distributed 12,000 copies a month, and it stimulated a rich intellectual debate about the future of the country. Now, it's been replaced by a couple of magazines, but they've been encountered repeated political opposition. There's one called Tel Kel, which was founded, I'd say about 20 something years ago. And they had devoted an issue to what's happened to Moroccan intellectuals and the university over the past couple of decades, corresponding to the shift in economic policy to market reform and neoliberalism. They quote Abdelkader Khatibi in the article, and he said, "In the past, we tried to decolonize our spirit in the domain of ideology, the human sciences and religious reform, to participate in a modern and advanced society. We produced intellectuals inside and outside the university." Another observer quoted in this article in Tel Kel from 2009 said, quote, "Everything was the object of discussion, sometimes interminable, a class at the university, a book, a film, a poem, a painting." This person also stressed that, quote, "In this period, intellectuals, writers, poets, painters, philosophers were not content to talk amongst themselves. They addressed society." Now, what's happened in the meantime with structural adjustment are two things that have affected the management of higher education. The first is deprivation of resources to public faculties, meaning that one, it's not as attractive and you can't hire as many younger faculty, and two, that those faculty that do teach in public universities are motivated financially and for their own status to teach in private universities or to become consultants for the World Bank or foreign aid organizations or for agencies in the government. In 2005, the government offered a voluntary retirement plan. And what it meant was a lot of senior staff within public services in general left and went to work in the private sector. In the article that I wrote on higher education, I quoted a woman who worked for an institute supported by the palace.
10 minutes left.
10 minutes left, cool, that's perfect. Okay, she said that about faculty, especially leading faculty that you would read about in the media, or you would know about through being a student who are well known in Morocco. she said, quote, the problem with this, with faculty, is that they engage in consulting work. They're not doing research. What they are doing is answering questions posed by development agencies. So you're not asking sort of a blue sky question or a question about a philosophical question or a sociological question about the future of the country. You're asking a question that an agency has asked you to ask. They aren't thinking independently, this person said. They're telling the agency what they want to hear. Then they may end up losing the ability to do research, in part because they're so pressed for time doing consulting work, and they can't teach research to graduate students either. So the universities lose out even more. There was a change in political narrative, and that's another component of this, alongside the deprivation of resources to public universities and the fact that a lot of the leading faculty then became preoccupied and you're a smaller cohort of younger faculty, especially those perhaps who've gone overseas to get their education. And I'll talk about that in just one second. You have a change in narrative that fits with what I've referred to, is that jobs were not, there's the loss of a sense of a job being existentially important. It's despite what the World Bank has found in its analyses of post-Arab Spring, it's about job as a human resource. Education should feed people into the job market like a human resource. And so if you look at King Mohammed VI's Discours Royal in August 2014, he spoke of developing qualified human resources as a major priority for enhancing competition and responding to the requirements of the development in the job market, as well as complementing the advancement and diversification of the national economy. But that isn't what you find on the ground. There's a discord, there's a dissonance between what he is talking about there and what you would find on the ground if you talk to people about what a job means to them and what an education means to them. But again, despite what they've found in their own work, the World Bank keeps pushing. In fact, last year, their warning of potential social tensions, again and again and again, repeating the same thing they've said for several decades, because of unemployment rates among highly educated men and women. But their answer was to accelerate structural reforms, improve the quality of education, and support labor market participation. Unfortunately, as you know, you could say this again and again and again, that these haven't worked despite investment in higher education. So I'm just going to end with a couple of statistics. Despite the fact that higher education doesn't necessarily lead to a job, in fact, it often does not lead to a job, there has been an explosion in higher education institutions in Morocco. Now, there are 24, since 2017, there have been 24 new higher and further education establishments that are open to all or in competitive that have opened. So then you, then the number of students in private universities has also grown. So from about 43,000, almost 44,000 in 2016 and 2017, to almost 60,000 in 2020 through 21. It's also the largest, the Moroccan student population in France is its largest expat student population. And this has been consistent for a number of years. There is a question though about who's going to France, whether or not it's, and again, this is the social mobility question, if it's the students who are from upper middle class and wealthier families because they've been able to go to private school and achieve a high result in the baccalaureate, or if in, or how many students of sort of more modest family backgrounds have been able to go. So, but I'll end with the unemployment data. In 2019, it's inequality data, which despite the fact that unemployment rates, as you've seen, are about a quarter of graduates, it's corresponded with higher rates of inequality that the top 20% of the population possesses about over 50% of household income, and the top 10% almost 40% of household income. And so that's versus 5.6% of the bottom 20% and 2.2% for the bottom 10%. So corresponding with all of this is a distance in income inequality. So the last question I'd ask is, what's to be done? there is a question about, yes, what is to be done? And I've argued elsewhere that the universities can be great cultivators of local economies that the investment, and this isn't just me, but there have been repeated studies since I wrote that article that said, one, you need to concentrate on the entire education system, not just higher education. You need to invest in higher education. It's resources that are available for research, but also for faculty. You need to train younger faculty to be better teachers and to be better researchers by giving them the opportunities. And then you need to coordinate between private, public education and what's needed by not just industry, but what's needed socially by NGOs. But again, cultivating universities as centers for local economic development, in that way, creating jobs in a local area. We're not having to push out younger generations to either go to cities like Casablanca or to seek migration as an outlet for unemployment. And then, I don't expect this to happen anytime soon, but with such persistent high unemployment rates, corresponding with much higher investment in higher education, you can only have persistence, perpetuation of a longstanding problem that's not going to go away, that's only going to create more problems politically and socially and economically for the region. Anyway, I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shana. Just a quick question I have, and we'll move to Magdalena's talk. Do you know what the general attendance rates are or have been recently in Morocco? So what percentage of the population broadly enters tertiary education in some format, even if they don't complete a degree?
That's an excellent question. And I think it's about a quarter, but I'm not positive. So
what are Moroccans students?
I'll look that up for you. And I should know that, but actually I don't off the top of my head.
I was just curious because we have so many state contexts just in our focus on the Middle East, North Africa. I wonder how widely just that statistic varies across the region.
I don't know the latest statistics. My information is a bit dated. I think it's slightly higher for Tunisia than it is for Morocco and Algeria in terms of percentage that goes on to higher education. And I think it's a quarter, but I will look at it for you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.